As a kid, you may have been given an allowance. We had to work for it at our house. This is how you were taught to save money, to put money in an envelope in your sock drawer because you're saving for the trip to the store. Everybody knows what happens when you make the long-awaited trip to the store. You get to go to the toy aisle, and you get to take your hard-earned cash and buy any toy you want to that you can afford, of course. But you're given permission, if you say. Now, at the store, you're on the toy aisle, and you see all the toys that are in front of you with their battery-powered doodads and their remote-controlled whatchamacallits. So many to choose from, of course. But you look over to your left, and it's as if a light bulb goes off. That's it. That's the one. That's the one I've been saving for, right there. I'm sure some of you are reliving your childhood as I speak. But you notice something. You look at the price tag, and you notice you're a few dollars short. Now, the one you really want is just a couple dollars more. You know you want a new toy today, though. You really want a new toy to take home today so you can show it off to your friends. The question then is this. Are you willing to wait till next week's allowance to buy the toy you really want? Or do you buy something else now on an impulse? Decisions, decisions, right? Now, there's this famous study led by some scientists at Stanford called the Marshmallow Experiment. You may have heard of it. These studies were aimed at testing the cognitive ability of children to delay gratification, if you will, when presented with a certain type of situation. Now, the study went something like this. The researchers would sit an individual child alone at a table in this particular room with a single small reward in front of them, be it a marshmallow or a cookie or something of the like. They were informed that they could have the one reward immediately, or they could have two rewards later. It all depended on if they were willing to wait just a short amount of time without eating the first reward. A period of maybe 15 minutes. Sounds intense. I know. I'm just at the edge of my seat myself if I was sitting down. To a kindergartner, though, 15 minutes is an eternity. You've got a marshmallow in front. Do you eat it? Do you not? Do you eat it? Do you not? You would be amazed at the outcomes of this study, though. Some kids were able to wait, and some others just couldn't handle the pressure. Now, this kind of stuff even follows us to adulthood. Just as soon as you hit high school, you're told what you do now matters for your future, for the rest of your life. It's extremely important that you buckle down now so that you can benefit later. After high school, it doesn't stop there, be it college or a career or even trade school or anything of the like. You're told that at that point, everything before was okay, but what matters is now. What you do now matters for the rest of your future. It seems to continually go the same route. What you do now really matters for what's in your future. You can put money away. You can save for retirement now so that later on you can benefit from it. This sounds pretty stressful as well. Maybe, just maybe, after all your work, you might can rest. Maybe then, when everything is taken care of, if you will, you can finally enjoy all of your work after school, after working, after retirement. Everything in life seems to come with a bit of sacrifice. Putting things aside now for a benefit later, be it a marshmallow or a toy or whatever in life comes up. This is where Paul is directing the faith community in Rome. In our passage today, it's one that you've probably read 100 times, but we'll read it again. We all need a reminder. It's coming from Romans 12, 1 through 8. I'll give you a second. It says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your rational worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body, we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually, we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, and finally the compassionate in cheerfulness. Will you pray with me? Great God, humble us today so that we may be capable of hearing you speak to us through your word. We thank you for the gift of yourself in your scripture. We rejoice in its complexity. Give us the simplicity to be confounded by your word. Strike us with your word. Direct us with your word. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Get one more sip. During this time period, though, of this letter, these words around sacrifice would be quite interesting, quite thought-provoking. The Christians of the first century would have stood out quite a bit for their views on sacrifice, if you will, their practices, or, in this case, lack thereof. Well, Christians were different anyway compared to the world around them. But especially because of the fact that they practiced no sacrificial ritual, named no one as priest, and looked to no temple like that of Jerusalem. So why in the world is Paul talking about sacrifice? We don't do that anymore, some might say. Wasn't Jesus the final and eternal sacrifice? Wasn't Jesus' death enough? Of course so. I mean, of course Jesus' death was enough, and indeed he was the final sacrifice. So what in the world is Paul talking about? Of course, Paul is aware of the circumstances of the people he's ministering to. There were groups all around them that would be practicing sacrifices for their beliefs, for their state, or for many other purposes. Sacrifice was all around. But Christians, they were called to be different. Now, Paul, as he is explaining this, he says, instead of going to the temple to make a sacrifice, I challenge you to make yourself a sacrifice. Whoa. Wait a minute. Sacrifices mean killing something, an animal or whatever, and offering it up to God, right? So you want us to do that to ourselves? That sounds silly, I know. But at first glance, it sounds like Paul wants the Roman Christians to commit a mass suicide as a sacrifice to God. But Christians today understand what Paul is really talking about. We get it, but the thing is, we're 2,000 years down the road. Now, the first century followers, the parallels between animal sacrifice and what he's calling for here would be quite evident. His imagery would have been a radical effect on those reading the letter for the first time. They would definitely get he's talking about something deep. Sacrifice. Now, Paul is calling for a particular kind of sacrifice. He says, present your bodies, a living sacrifice. This is no blood sacrifice. This is quite different. Paul is calling the Romans to be an ongoing, continuous, living sacrifice. Now, what does it mean to be a living sacrifice? What does it mean to be alive in the first place? Now, this is a topic of much debate, especially around the issues related to human life. You hear about this stuff all the time, and I'm not poking the bear, I'm just making a point. What is a human life? Where does it begin? Where does it end? What is it worth? Confronting such issues as abortion or the death penalty, euthanasia, or even the hot topic discussions around immigration, refugee acceptance, and even border control. You hear them all the time on the radio, all over the news. At the center of all of these discussions, though, is the issue of human life. At what point can you say life has begun? At what point do you say life has ended? What is the worth of each human life? Are some lives worth more than others simply because of status, financial wealth, or just where they happen to be located around the world? If a person living under constant threat of death, residing in another country that is in the midst of civil war, can we properly say they're living? I mean, living in terror is not truly living. Having to flee a country because of terror and fear for your life is surely not living. Granted, a person may be breathing oxygen and blood may be pumping through their veins, but are they truly living? Merely breathing oxygen is not living. You may be alive, but living, it's much more than that, right? Each person on earth has been given life. And the Bible says that that life comes from God, something completely and distinctively different. Jesus said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And Paul mentions just a few chapters before in the same letter we're looking at today that is through our baptism into Christ, we also have been buried with him, but also raised to walk in newness of life. This is much more than a mundane grind of everyday living. This is much more than just simply getting by. Life. Now, what does life and living have to do with a sacrifice? Now, Paul is calling for a different kind of sacrifice. He says to present our whole beings as a living sacrifice, not just a little bit, your whole self. Now, we just recently celebrated Valentine's Day. You may know this, a week ago. It was on February 14th. Now, this is the day when folks pledge their deep love and commitment to one another. This is the day when 6 million people were expecting or planning a marriage proposal. Now, it's also the day before February 15th, which is the day when all the stores mark their Valentine's Day candy down to 75% off. It's another note, but commitment is what I'm talking about. This is not a half-hearted thing. All these folks are making commitments to one another. It's not something you take lightly. You're either all in or you're not. There's no halfway when it comes to this kind of commitment. And this is what Paul was drawing on. He's calling for a commitment in a similar fashion, kind of. Sacrifice. So what is sacrifice? We're currently in the season of Lent, which is a period of 40 plus days, give or take Sundays or whatever, how you want to do the math, between Ash Wednesday and Easter. 40 days, looking back on the time when Israel was wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. 40 days, looking back on the time when rain fell on Noah for 40 straight days as well. It's also 40 days, looking back on the time when Jesus was fasting and being tempted in the desert. So for 40 days, God's people contemplate the cross, fixing our eyes on the Savior that bore the sin of the entire world. Some people take this time to fast or to give things up, to more clearly focus on our Savior through study and prayer. So we find ourselves in the second week of Lent, on the journey to the cross. A season of repentance. A period of time for us as followers to examine our hearts before celebrating Jesus' resurrection. A period of sacrifice. But Paul's word is not just about a 40-day period of sacrifice. He's calling for a daily life of sacrifice. Lent and Easter are just the beginning. He calls this our worship, our daily sacrifice. So I don't know if you've seen it yet or not, but I titled this sermon, "The Sacrifice That Just Won't Die." If you like that or not, you can quote it and tweak that if you want to. But this is what we're talking about. The sacrifice that just won't quit. It won't die. Now, there was a man who received a promotion once to the position of vice president at a company that he worked for. The promotion very quickly went to his head. And for weeks on end, he bragged to anyone and to everyone that he was now vice president. His bragging eventually came to an abrupt halt when his wife, so embarrassed by his behavior, said to him, "Listen, Bob, it's not that big of a deal. These days, everyone is a vice president. Why, they even have a vice president of the peas section down at the supermarket." Somewhat deflated, of course, Bob picked up the phone. He called his local supermarket to find out if the story was true. "Hello? Can I speak to the vice president of peas, please?" he asked, to which the reply came, "Which one? A fresh or frozen?" There was an executive of a very large tech company giving performance evaluations to all of his department. And this was a regular practice he liked to do so as to keep a tabs on things and to help make predictions for the next quarter's earnings. And reviewing each top-level employee, this is a big deal. These are top-level sales representatives for this tech company. The executive came to a trend. They each were getting stumped by his last question that he had on the evaluation. These were top salesmen, best in the field, who were getting stumped on a simple evaluation. The question read, "What is the first name of the woman who cleans the offices on your floor?" No one could answer. The executive would respond saying, "All are important in our company. All are equally valuable to our success. It takes all of us to get the job done." So in likewise fashion, between these two stories, Paul addresses the Christians in Rome in verse 3, saying for them to not think too highly of themselves. Don't fill yourself up with pride because of the gifts that you've been given. This sounds great, but what in the world does this have to do with sacrifice? He says that we are the body of Christ multiple times throughout all the letters he sends. But we're church people here. We all know what that means. We all know what Paul means when he says this. That means we're the doers, right? Christ is the head, we're the body, we're the doers. But we've been talking about this for 2,000 years. Of course, we've got this one figured out. Maybe so, but sometimes the body aches. Sometimes it ails, and sometimes it's sore, and sometimes your back gets tight. Sometimes we need to go to the doctor or take some medicine. Sometimes we forget things. Everybody needs a reminder every now and then. I know I sure do. You could ask Kaylee. So about this body, just like a literal body, it has many members. And not all of them have the same function. If they did, we'd all be an awful mess. You could just picture it now. This means that we have different jobs, but that we have to work together. Just picture two legs fighting with one another about which one's going to go first. Argue long enough about it, and you might literally be causing yourself to stumble. And then there's yet another trip to the doctor. He mentions a list of gifts. You might also think you fit into some of these. But you might also think that some of these are more important than others. But there's no difference from the story above that I mentioned, that each member is equally important, just like the body. And that even the littlest parts have a big impact. If you don't believe me, ask someone who's had the slightest back pain. It'll take you out, and you can't even go anywhere. Or someone who's had a toothache. It takes you out. You can't speak, you can't eat, you can't do anything. There's littlest details. We need those teeth. We need those pinky toes. The success of us as a body of Christ is dependent on all the little members as well. We need you to make it all happen. So this is our task of sacrifice. This is our call to be a living sacrifice together. And Paul calls our sacrifice a rational worship. You might be wondering, what is that? Meaning it's what we are meant to do. We as rational beings, something sets us apart from all the rest of creation. The ability to think and to be cognitive, it's our fitting duty to worship God. It's what we were made to do. And you do that by making yourself a sacrifice. But this is a corporate call. This is a call to sacrifice together, not individually. So in regards to this season of Lent, on this road to or journey to the cross, what are you willing to sacrifice? Will you pray with me? God, give us the strength to be your servants. Give us the strength to be a living sacrifice. We are ministers of your gospel, called to service, but we confess that we fear the power that you bestow on us to be able to serve. Help us, therefore, to be servants of your joy. As through joy, we are freed from coercion and violence of the everyday. We thank you for making us representatives of your kingdom. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. So if you are here today and you feel led by the Holy Spirit to make some sort of sacrifice, or make some sort of commitment, or if you just need to pray, feel free to come down front and I'll be here to receive you.